John Embry, precious metals industry professional for over 30 years, senior advisor at Sprott Asset Management, a favorite of our Gold Seek network. Welcome back, John Embry.
Well, it's nice to be back, Chris. Pleasure to chat with you.
Always a pleasure to have you here. You were expressing some discontent and disappointment, obviously. You know, we've seen a lot of volatility in our favorite sector. And, you know, we've had colleagues on here of yours and others who have said that maybe there was some big manipulation. For instance, Rob Kirby noted that there was something like 8,000 tons of gold dumped on this market. That's 16 million pounds or 256 million ounces paper following the presidential election, and it looks like a huge manipulation scheme.
Well, I know Rob well, and I have a high regard for his thought process, and I think he's dead right. I mean, basically, they got, I think what I could refer to as the deep state, the people behind the curtain, got wrong-footed to some extent with Trump's election, and they moved heaven and earth to make sure that nothing got disrupted. You know, everybody thought that were Trump to be elected, it would be like Brexit. The gold price would go bonkers on the upside, which it did briefly in the middle of the night. And that's when they unleashed this massive selling attack, which started a downward trend. And what's happened subsequently on COMEX, I mean, there's been a massive wipeout of the open interest. I think from the peak, it was something like 668,000 contracts. As of yesterday, it's just down to over 400,000. That's sort of 26 million ounces of paper gold wiped out on COMEX. That's all part and parcel of this process. I think it's prelude to a major move up. I think the boys know this, and they're sort of cleaning the decks and getting rid of their short positions and what have you. So am I discouraged? No. Am I irritated? Yes.
Do you have any comments on the U.S. dollar strength? I mean, obviously that at least has coincided with these strategies and schemes they've put into place. Is that just an effect of their manipulations?
That's an excellent question, Chris. Like, I think that, you know, Trump's election isn't necessarily good for the rest of the world. Like, I mean, if he follows up in some of his policies. And I don't know that you could say the U.S. dollar is strong. I would prefer to say that the other currencies are weak. As my friend and partner Eric Sprott said years ago, and I love the expression, he said, you know, trying to pick the best currency in the world is trying to pick the best-looking horse in the glue factory.
As you say, there was a lot of reallocation of institutions, big players, hedge funds, deep pockets. Folks were caught off guard to some extent, maybe some anticipation of a Brexit-like event, though, too, having seen that 6 to 8 months ago earlier. Once this euphoria and or dissatisfaction wears off, what's the next piece to move on the chessboard here?
Irrespective of who is the president of the United States, it is going to be difficult, if not impossible, to get a growth scenario in the economy for the very simple reason, and I'm a big believer in Austrian economics, when you have infinitely too much debt in a system, you cannot grow sustainably. On that premise, if Trump follows up in his plans to cut taxes and undertake massive infrastructure spending, this, that, and the other thing, I think budget deficits will blow out. And we'll be sort of on the early stages on the trip to hyperinflation. But right now, everybody's euphoric. Things are going to be terrific, but they aren't going to be terrific. And it's just going to be a matter of how long it's going to take to, before people figure that out.
Unfortunately, I think the word was used too often. I'm probably guilty by association. The hyperinflation term was overused starting with 2006, and I think it turns people off. They've read about it in the blogosphere too much. But unfortunately, this time when the boy cries, I mean, there really will be a pack of wolves. And, you know, we've had John Williams from Shadow Stats last week, Peter Schiff, they're both in your camp. They completely back up and corroborate everything you say that hyperinflation could be an understatement. And then we see what's happening just south of our border in Venezuela. Shopkeepers don't even look at bills anymore. They just weigh them by the bag load for a few basic necessities. Most necessities are gone. You can't find toiletries. People forget this was the shining star of South America. I mean, this was the, you might say, the America of South America. And in just the blink of an eye, things are out of control. One message today noted that Trump is considering a gold standard advocate as Treasury Secretary. It might be a bit too much to hope that we would have some type of gold standard in just the next few years.
Didn't he just appoint Mnuchin, the guy from Goldman Sachs? We're dealing with such incredible uncertainty here because we've got a guy in there who is not a politician. And, you know, you really don't know what's going to happen in the near term.
No, it's well said, and I think that's the appeal. It's interesting because 8 years ago when President Obama came to power, it was the internet, I felt, that catapulted him into the presidency, and we've seen that again with Trump. I mean, if you looked at Trump's numbers online, the polls showed him they were abysmal, but when you looked at the number of folks reading his information, it was something like 20 times the opposition. So I really feel that this was a groundswell similar to Brexit. We're certainly hoping that there will be that big change. But I'm afraid that people might be disappointed yet again, because how much can one person really do?
I mean, the problems are so deep-seated. People are inherently optimistic. They want to believe in something better. And I mean, what Trump does represent is change. He is not the old guard's, you know, politician. So this is, and then the honeymoon phase is looked upon positively. And I'd like to be positive, too. Unfortunately, I sort of, all the kind of work I do suggests that things are going to get worse rather than better.
And certainly there is the opportunity here to hopefully make we the people a more important moniker than we the cronies. For the most part, there's been a mindset that has been detrimental to society. Where I think many folks just have turned off the television. We haven't had a TV running in our house for almost 15 years.
I'm a sports fan, so I have my TV, but it's only on sports.
No, we were tickled to see the Chicago Cubs finally win the World Series. Wasn't that something? But, you know, I wanted to move on here to the situation with Prime Minister Modi in India, you know, wiping out the 500 and 1,000 rupee notes, you know, their largest. And then he announced that he wants to eliminate all cash and go to a cashless society. This in a society where 89% of daily transactions take place using some paper. That would seem to be a big plus for the precious metals, because people are once again nervous and put off by this type of, as you say, uncertainty.
This attack on cash, and it's not only in India, it's in Australia, and it's sort of building momentum globally. I'm totally opposed to it. I mean, it's just more state control because they can monitor every single thing you do. So, yeah, I think on that premise alone, like, if you can't own cash and you've got to have everything sort of in paper in the system, I would heavily endorse gold out of the system. Don't have it. Make sure you know where it is and it's in a safe place. But, yeah, I think that's a tremendous positive. And I would make one other comment, and that is that I believe India is under the complete influence of the United States. So I think this is sort of a trial run for this cashless society stuff. Head of the Bank of India, who resigned not that long ago, was U.S. trained, and he was clearly in there at the U.S.'s behest.
A puppet Treasury Secretary or monetary official, that again is just worth taking note. I was unaware of that. And, you know, as we wrap up here today, just wanted to throw in a recent comment from John Hathaway, of course, the head of...
I've been following Hathaway's work. I know him quite well, and he's been one of the guys all along, Chris, that's been really spot on in his analysis of gold.
He just penned an article saying that the U.S. presidential election involved the dumping of 2 years' production of gold.
The people who are being taken advantage of, who are those that think these are real markets today with all the new financial innovation. I mean, between derivatives, high-frequency trading, algorithms, et cetera, it's very easy to do.
I think you're right. And the key word there was derivatives, because it just gives them such amazing leverage. And these products get more and more fancy. I mean, there's so many bells and whistles, and the opportunity to do this, I think, without transparency is the word I'm looking for, that makes it so detrimental to society. All right. Well, as we wrap up, any topicality we've missed today?
I love the United States. I spent a lot of time there. You know, I think the people that have supported Trump, he's going to be disappointed over the next several years, because you're not going to be able to get the economic lift and the improvement of their living standards that they're hopeful for. And I'm worried about how they will respond to that.
What I hope is people are level-headed and recognize how much can we expect one person to accomplish in 4 years after 40 years.
Chris, I mean, it all started when they took the U.S. dollar off the remove the gold backing. That began the slippery slide to a debt crisis that is going to be ginormous.
Well, see, that's approaching 50 years, you know, with Nixon and the gold window. I think that was 71 or 70.
45 years plus now, you're right.
We all remember what happened during that decade to gold. Do you see another moment like that in the future?
Man, I'm on record as saying this, in my opinion, when you look at the price of gold and silver in relation to the amount of debt and currency, et cetera, in the world, I'm not sure they've ever been cheaper than they are as we speak at this moment. I think the guys that know what's going on, the boys behind the scene, the bullion bankers, the central bankers, that's one of the reasons why they're having this vicious takedown of gold, because they're reversing their positions. They're getting the longs out, and they're covering their shorts.
Please tell people more about Sprott Asset Management and any other contact information you'd like to leave.
Money manager. We're great proponents of gold, and you can go to our website, www.sprott.com, and there's quite a wide variety of information. I would encourage people to look at it.
Always appreciate your thoughts, and hopefully you'll have more for us in 2017, as I suspect this is going to be a very interesting year yet again for the precious metals.
Well, I quite frankly, 2016 worked out a lot better for the bulls than I would have thought, so we'll see how 2017 goes.
Almost all of the rallies of the last 5 years fizzled out, but not 2016. We've had some selling, but we're still up for the year.
Oh, it's remarkable. Like, I mean, I was a long-term stock jockey, and I've never, this is one of the most expensive markets I've ever seen, particularly when you factor in the deteriorating fundamentals like profits and economic activity, etc.
John Embry, we always appreciate your thoughts, sir.
It's always nice to talk to you, Chris, anytime.